Good morning. Welcome to Star of Bethlehem Lutheran Church. It is the fourth Sunday in Advent. Christmas is almost here. We begin our worship of our God in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Please stand. Today, at all four corners of our Advent wreath, there is light shining. And in all four corners of the earth, our God is dwelling. The light of God's presence was revealed to Mary when Gabriel appeared in glory before her. And the light of God's presence spreads to all the world through the offspring of her womb. The light of God's presence covers the landscape and shines into every home. And the light of God's presence circles the globe with its rays until every face feels warmth of God's sun. The light of God's presence rules over the shadows in the sunshine. And the light of God's presence reaches into every dark and troubled heart with healing, confidence, and hope, the birth of Jesus Christ. Let the light of the Lord shine around us and in us. And let us shine forth as beacons of faith in all the world. We continue with our Advent gathering rite. The refrain will be sung through once by the soloist. The congregation will join in the second time and then continue during the verses. With the clouds, all the nations will be gathered before him to be judged. Lest that day surprise us unprepared, let us make confession of our sins, imploring our heavenly Father to have mercy on us for the sake of Jesus Christ. Most merciful God, we confess to you all our sins and iniquities with which we have offended you in our thinking, in our speaking, and in our doing. We have distrusted your promises, dismissed your messengers, disobeyed your directives. We have failed to be your obedient servants, subject to your word. We beg your forgiveness for the sake of Jesus Christ and seek the help of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Come, Emmanuel. Come,
Lord, have mercy upon us and come. Christ, have mercy upon us and come.
O highly favored ones, the Lord is with you. Born of the Virgin Mary, Jesus Christ was given to die for you. For his sake, your sins are forgiven. With God, nothing is impossible. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be the glory forever. Amen. Surely he is coming soon. And so we sing,
Come, Emmanuel.
At this time, I invite the children of the congregation to come forward for the children's message. Good morning, boys and girls. I have another ornament off of our Christmas tree. It is a chrismon. It's just a fancy term for a church Christmas ornament. What is it? Can you guys tell? It is a butterfly. Nice. Did you see butterflies at Christmas time? No. Yeah, thank you. They hibernate. Yeah, so what's going on here with the butterfly on the Christmas tree? Can any of you think of why in the world we would go to the trouble to make a butterfly and then hang it on the Christmas tree? And it's got to have some church significance, right? To do with God or Jesus or something? You got nothing, Tessa? Anybody? Ladies? What do you think? I see what you're thinking. Oh, I see what you're thinking. Yeah, that's true, but usually we think about clovers with three like that in. Four is too many. Yeah, just three, because our God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The butterfly doesn't really have anything to do with Christmas, but it's got a lot to do with Jesus. You got to fast forward a couple months. Think April, springtime, Easter bunnies, Easter eggs, empty tombs. It's Easter, yeah. You don't know. The butterfly is a symbol of Jesus rising from the dead. It is. And so the reason why it's on the Christmas tree is just for us to connect the dots, for us to see that baby who was born in Bethlehem, right? He's God. That's Jesus. He was the one who died on the cross to take away your sins. And he's the one who rose from the dead. Yeah. Okay. Well, it's really good that we have a butterfly on our Christmas tree, because that way you think Jesus isn't just a cute little baby. He's my Savior. And because he lives forever, so will I. Death can no longer touch me. I will live with him forever in heaven. That is why there's a butterfly on your Christmas tree, on our tree. Let's fold our hands and pray. Dear Jesus, we praise you for coming to us at Christmas time. You were born, and we needed you to be. We needed you to live in our place and die in our place. And because you live, you rose from the dead. We know that one day we will rise from the dead too and live with you forever. Lord Jesus, we praise you. Amen. You're excused to go to your Sunday school class walking slowly. Our first lesson is taken from 2 Samuel Chapter 7, verses 8 through 16. This lesson speaks of the promised Messiah's coming in both grace and judgment. Jesus is the ultimate fulfillment of these promises made to David. We see the fulfillment in the gospel lesson. The Son of God and Mary's Son will create a home for God's people. The Son of God and Mary's Son will be punished for their sins. The Son of God and Mary's Son will remain forever to shield, shelter, and save those whom God brings into his eternal house and kingdom. What's left for us to do? Nothing but to welcome and receive him. Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture and from following the flock to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men of the earth. And I will provide a place for my people Israel and will plant them so that they have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people will not oppress them anymore as they did at the beginning and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, who will come from your own body, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him with the rod of men, with floggings inflicted by men. My love will never be taken away from him, as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever. We stand for the words of our King. Our gospel lesson is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. Luther notes that the Virgin Mother of God received the message of the Incarnation with a simple yes. She did not shave her head and enter a convent. She did not set herself up on a throne to be worshipped. She did nothing but receive. She did not pretend to grasp all that the angel said or its full implication. All she knew was that the message came from God, and that whatever he was about to give, even his only begotten Son, she was ready to receive. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son. You are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I'm a virgin." The angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who is said to be barren is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. This is the gospel of our Lord. We bow our heads in prayer. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come. Take away the burden of our sins, and make us ready for the celebration of your birth, that we may receive you in joy and serve you always. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. We continue with our hymn of the day, hymn 23, O Come, Emmanuel.
and ransomed captive Israel, that mourns in holy exile, until the Son of God appear.
Grace, mercy, and peace are yours in abundance from God our Lord and Savior, Christ Jesus. Our text for meditation this morning is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans, the last three verses. Now to him who is able to establish you by my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings, for the command of the eternal God, so that all nations might believe and obey him. For the only wise God be glory forever, through Jesus Christ. Amen. So far, text. Christian friends, there are a couple ways that you can tell that Christmas is near. One of them is that when you go past the mall, it's very difficult to get through a stoplight without it turning red again because there's so many cars around you. Every corner, the corners where when you go to the mall normally you say, who would actually park out there? You have to walk across a little mall street to get to the mall. Those are being used right now. That's a little odd, isn't it? That it's so busy. When you turn on the TV, there are Christmas specials. Nick, can you? Yeah. How many of you know who that is? Does anyone not know who that is? Yeah. Yeah, even the very young. Yeah, that's Rudolph. Maybe you could even mention Rudolph's girlfriend, couldn't you? We are so engrossed in this Christmas culture. And yet I wonder, if you had someone who didn't know anything about Jesus or Christmas, according to the Bible, if they came into Western civilization, would they be able to figure out the true meaning of Christmas? Between Santa, Frosty, Rudolph, a whole slew of other Christmas movies that are pumped out every year, could you tell? A couple weeks ago, we had Christmas for kids here, and Jenna was reading some books to the kids about Christmas. And she goes through and she tries to make it interactive and she asks questions about it. And this was the first year where a child truly had no idea, the child was completely ignorant about any of the details of the biblical Christmas story. No clue. This was an old child, I'm talking 10. The child didn't know. The child lived in Winston-Salem. That's disturbing. That you can live in America, and with all of the media that surrounds Christmas, be ignorant of what Christmas truly is. The Apostle Paul could not have imagined the cesspool that is Western civilization in 2014, but he did know about Christmas. He knew about secrets. And in this letter to the Romans, as he closes out, he says, the secret is out. You can take off, Rudolph. It was foretold long ago through the prophets. It is proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus. Did you know that yesterday was a very important day in our country? Our nation's newest national park was established yesterday. Nick, can you? Blackstone River Valley National Park in Rhode Island. It has some incredible amounts of history. If you do a little bit of research through that, that's a picture of the first functioning cotton mill in our country. It's right there. There's a hodgepodge. Nick, push the next slide. Fruit of the Loom, that was the original. Yeah, that graces the underwear of so many of you. That was the original before the 1918 World's Fair when they changed it to the one that was so customary. That's where it started, was at this Black River. And that's the first Tupperware party. It's ridiculous, some of the history that goes around with it. You can say that there's good reason to establish a national park there. Nick, you see. Now, what does Paul say in the very first verse? You catch it? Now to him who is able to establish you. We establish national parks, don't we? Something that's very worthwhile, right? Something that lasts the test of time, has history associated with it. Christian. God is able to establish you. I mean, is there a monument that goes with you? What is it that makes you so special? I'm not saying that God can't do it. We just heard the angel tell Mary what's going to happen. I mean, all things are possible with our God. I believe that. And I don't doubt that God has the power to establish faith in your heart. What I doubt is God's reasoning. Why would he want to do that? To me. Am I worthy of having my God indwell in my heart? It's kind of a breathtaking thought that he would establish you as his child. Now, this isn't the first time that Paul's spoken about it. The book of Romans is an awesome book. For so many of these letters that Paul writes, it's a follow-up letter. He visits all the places that he writes to because they know him. Romans, not so much. He didn't get there. That's part of why Romans is so dogmatic. It oozes with teaching, organized, beautifully outlined. It's a gift to the church, of course, and it's the word of our God. But he didn't get to go visit them. He lays out exactly why they need their God. He lays out why the question that I ask isn't necessarily a bad one. Why would God want to establish me? And yet I know that he does. You see, I know that my God cares about me because he says so. My God loves me and has never stopped. You see, the secret's out, and it was foretold through the prophets. Listen once more. The mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God. That word secret is an interesting one. Nick, can you? Yeah, that is eggnog. And I think everyone's grandma, at least mine did, has a secret eggnog recipe. And I always wonder about some of these eggnog recipes because some kids are not allowed to drink. Now, I don't think there's anything really secret about the eggnog recipe because it's probably something that 50, 75 years ago everyone did, of course. what's so secret about that? So what is it that makes it such a secret? It's been known for a long time, hasn't it? And yet it just kind of fell out of knowledge, right? Because what Paul says is almost confusing. A mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through prophetic writings. These are really old. I'm talking thousands of years. One of the hallmarks of biblical interpretation is prophecy and fulfillment. God promises, God keeps his promise, right? That's one of the things that makes our God so awesome, is that he keeps all of those promises. And to make the verbal inspiration even more amazing, this is God's word, of course. This is our eternal God. It's timeless, right? He doesn't have a beginning, and he doesn't have an end. And this is his word inserted into time for us to believe and know. You see, the secret is out, and it's one that is very old. It's just that people kind of forgot about it, right? It's one that Paul knew about, and yet so many people didn't. You see, the secret is out. It's proclaimed, it was foretold to the prophets, but it's proclaimed in the gospel. If you can take off the ignition. Okay? Do you ever wonder why Paul uses the word mystery so much? Maybe it's because he's talking to Gentiles who didn't know all this stuff. The Jews had all these prophecies, right? At least you think. So many of them missed the boat too. But for the Gentiles, the chosen audience of the Apostle Paul, he uses the word mystery at least five different ways. He says that it was a mystery that the gospel could actually be revealed to the Gentiles. You see, Christmas was originally proclaimed to Jews. Those angels above the fields of Bethlehem, those were all Jewish shepherds. All the people that came to that manger were Jews. Epiphany, yeah, that's for the rest of us. Now, there's nothing wrong with celebrating Christmas. It's okay. But the wise men in our manger scene didn't get there for a couple years. They can still worship, but that was a mystery that even Gentiles could be included. It was a mystery that God could take on human flesh. How do you do that? Our God is a spirit. He says so in the Psalms. And he takes on a body just like me. I'm glad that he did so he could live under God's law and live in my place and die in my place. And that brings us to the next mystery Paul talks about. These are all mysteries. He uses the same word. How could God die? Think about that. I just said he was eternal. And now he's going to die? Is that possible? Yeah. Even more so than physical death, remember, spiritual death is eternity in hell. And that's the death that Jesus had to take care of for you. He did. That brings us to the next mystery. It's a little bit more, well, confusing, but on the last day, Jesus is the sum of all things. All things will come and be put underneath him. I can't imagine that. I still look at petty dictatorships in Cuba, North Korea, and cyber terrorism. And I wonder, how is it all going to work? And my God says, don't worry about it. I got this. Every knee will bow on the last day. Don't worry. And that brings me to the final mystery that Paul talked about. That's the resurrection. The butterfly, where it is a mystery that you will get a brand new glorified body. I don't know exactly what it's going to look like, but it's going to be yours. Same one that you have now, only perfect in every way. Those mysteries aren't really mysteries for you, are they? I say the secret is out, and you know that it's proclaimed in the gospel. And so that brings me back to my first establishment point. You are a child of God. I say I don't know why that's a half-truth. I do this for a living. I go back into God's word every week, and I'm big into it in my mind, the truth that he gives me. And I see how much he loves me. And I see all of the promises that he has associated with it, and I know that they're mine. And so did Paul. Listen to what he says. This is back in the first verse. Now to him who is able to establish you by my gospel, the proclamation of Jesus. Paul claims it as his own. This is my gospel. He's not being conceited. He's just telling the truth. You see, there wasn't a New Testament when Paul walked around and did his work. He wrote a big chunk of it. The Gospels were maybe being written as he worked, but they weren't readily available. You see, Paul went out and was knocked off his horse literally on the way to Damascus as he was doing his own version of terrorism among Christians. And then, do you know what happened? Paul went into the desert of Arabia. Listen to Galatians, starting with verse 15. But when God, who set me apart from birth and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his Son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not consult any man, nor did I go to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was. But I went immediately into Arabia and later returned to Damascus. For 3 years, the next verse tells us, he was tutored by Jesus. It's just kind of like a blank hole that we don't know a whole lot about that Paul just brushes over. And so when he says, this is my gospel, I know what I'm talking about. And the next phrase, this is the gospel that, and the proclamation of Jesus Christ. That's the essence of what it is. So when you hear the gospel that you know so well, you are so far from ignorant, my fellow Christians. It's ridiculous. You know a ridiculous amount. It's awesome that you can share. The secret's out. It needs to be made known by you. Nick, you. I have a colleague who went to San Francisco. And there's a number of street vendors, and he went out, and there was one that had a bunch of jewelry. And some of it was Christian jewelry. Like that little crucifix. And there was a couple that was perusing through it, and she picked it up and she said to her SO, look at this. You see this little man on the plus sign? Now you might say, that's ridiculous, Pastor. Is it really? Are we so naive that we think it's not a secret? Paul, everyone knows this stuff. Or are we in America 2014? Have we gone full circle back to the days in Rome when Paul wrote letters to people who truly did not know anything about Jesus? You are in a post-religious society in America. Do you realize that? I hear this at pastors' conferences when papers are presented and professors talk to me about this stuff. But we live in a very Christian part of America. We almost don't see it. But it's there. There are people who truly don't know, or they only know a facade of Christianity. They don't know about those five mysteries I just went through with you. They just don't know. That doesn't mean there's anything wrong with them. It just means someone needs to tell them. It just means that you need to be the one to let the secret out. This secret that is very old, that was proclaimed and prophesied in the Old Testament. And it's one that you can proclaim. People at Christmas time. Amen. Please stand. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. We confess our Christian faith using the words of the Nicene Creed found in your worship folder. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Please be seated. In just a few moments, you'll have the opportunity to receive Jesus' body and blood, the very body that was given into death for your sins, the blood that was shed for you on the cross. If you don't know what the Lord's Supper is all about, or if you don't know what our church teaches in general, I ask that you wait before you come forward. For those of you who will be communing with us, please do examine yourself using the words of personal preparation on page 156 in the front of your hymn. Please stand for prayer. Come, dear Savior, we long for your appearing. Come to cheer us with your promises as you once cheered your ancient people throughout their long night of waiting and watching. Come to restore our hope, rouse us from the slumber of despair, lift our hearts from petty earthbound goals, and direct our eyes above, from where you will soon come to make all things right again. Come and work in us godly grief and a genuine sorrow over sin. Forgive us for the shameful way we have dishonored you, the shabby way we have dealt with one another. For your mighty words stir up in us a ceaseless yearning to give ourselves to others as you have given yourself to us. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Come quickly, dear Lord, and fill our longing eyes with the light of your coming. We wait, we keep watch, and in you we put our hope. We join in the prayer that you've taught us, Lord. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Through his holy prophets, he promised a king to bring light to those living in darkness and the shadow of death. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. The Lord's table has been prepared. I now invite the members of our church to come forward following the direction of the usher.
Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. The Lord bless you, keep you, and bless you. May these, the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior, strengthen and preserve you in the knowledge of the one true faith and the life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. May these, the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior, strengthen and preserve you in the knowledge of the one true faith and the life everlasting. Depart in peace, for your sins are forgiven. Amen. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Lord, bless you. Take a drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. May these, the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior, strengthen and preserve you in the knowledge of the one true faith and the life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior. Shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. May these, the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior, strengthen and preserve you in the knowledge of the one true faith and the life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen.
please stand for the song of thanks.
Lord, now grant us peace as we bring this your table. Of your body and your blood. We have here seen your salvation freely given to the nation, source of life for all creation and for all of us.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. O God the Father, source of all goodness, in your loving kindness you sent your Son to share our humanity. We thank you that through him you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We also pray that you will not forsake us, but will rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we willingly serve you day after day. Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. We close our worship with our final hymn, hymn 41, selected verses. Let all together praise our God. There is just one announcement that did not make it into your worship folder, and that is Christmas Eve service will be this Wednesday at 5:30. At 5:30, there will be a Christmas Eve candlelight service here. Nick, keep them coming. Oh, and nice. Mary did tell me yesterday that the new flower calendar has been posted for 2015. Reserve your Sunday today. And if you want two Sundays, usually people share, or they work it out. That's what we do. All right. Next, his name is Jesus. We continue our series on the names of Christ and the